Breathing. There we go. Welcome. You're listening to the Best of Investing on News Talk 910. You know our show. It's where we present valuable information about real estate, the financial markets, and other economic business of the day. And for those of you listening for the first time, here's our format. Imagine a few guys sitting around a bar having drinks without the drinks, unfortunately. Talking business with you, the audience listening in. Today's going to be a really cool show. Make sure you pay attention. I'm your host, Edward Brown, and I'm pleased to have as my co-host Mark Hanf of Pacific Private Money, California's fastest-growing private lender, and Robert Schiff of RPM Mortgage. Our phone number is 888-912-1190. Now write that number down, 888-912-1190, because you're going to use that number to answer the trivia questions for three vacations given away during each commercial break. You got it. We're giving away nine vacations during this show. Vacations are sponsored by Lighthouse Resort and Marina, which is located 1 hour northeast of San Francisco, and the vacations are free. Their only request, a $75 cleaning fee to cover housekeeping expenses. That's a mouthful, huh? And their website is lighthouse4fun.com. You can reach them at 916-777-5511. Check them out. And today's trivia theme is teammate nicknames. That's kind of a cool one. Our website is bestofinvesting.com. Check us out on Facebook and YouTube by typing Best of Investing Radio Show. And we're also on television, Comcast Channel 26, on Saturdays at noon and Sundays at 6 p.m. Now, today's special guest is Michael McNair from IRA Trust Services Company.
Hey, Edward, it's good to be with you today. Thanks very much for the introduction.
You're welcome. I mean, Robert, yeah, I know you got a question for him.
Well, can you explain what is a self-directed IRA? Utilize it and why they might.
Sure, be happy to. First of all, the term self-directed IRA has been around a long time, and it really doesn't do justice to what we do. Most brokerage firms will talk about having self-directed investments, but generally speaking, they're limited to securities, mutual funds, and the like. So a self-directed IRA in today's market is one in which the investor decides what it is they want to invest in. And that can range from investing in real estate, in limited partnerships, LLCs, purchasing precious metals, all of these types of assets.
See, I don't think a lot of people know
how that can be within an IRA.
Yeah, because in the old days, it used to be just going to a bank,
yes,
and opening up an IRA. But over the years, it's changed quite a bit.
Right. And the fact is, we've been handling these kinds of assets for over 30 years, back in the day when they were doing real estate limited partnerships,
yeah,
and they were selling through broker-dealer networks.
Sure.
People would contribute $2,000, the amount of their IRA contribution limit at the time, and lo and behold, they would hold those. We still have some of those investments 30
wow.
years later. Yeah.
So this is really an important topic, Michael. This is Mark with Pacific Private Money, and we're talking about self-directed IRAs. Most or many people have 401ks or IRAs, but the self-directed IRA is a super important tool, particularly in the environment we've been in for the last several years and looking forward remain to be in, which is this low interest rate environment. And I know that a lot of my clients who fund loans that we originate through our company use their self-directed IRAs to fund loans where they can achieve high yields of interest. So it's really it's the ability for the investor out there, the average investor, to be able to invest in what is known as alternative asset classes for higher yields. Because quite frankly, you can invest in stocks and bonds and munis and such like that through pretty much just anyone, 401k or IRA. But you know, I think we all know that most people are not on track to retire successfully, and they need to increase the yields they earn on their retirement savings. And I believe that one of the best ways to do that is through a self-directed IRA.
Yeah, that's how I want to buy all my lottery tickets. So let's talk about if someone
has an IRA and they go to whoever the IRA is with and say, okay, I want to invest in real estate.
The answer could be one of two things. If they were honest, they could say, well, we don't do that, but there are people out there, there are companies, and specifically non-depository trust companies, that will handle that for you. And some of the brokerage firms have actually come a long way. I think Edward Jones is one of them that will happily refer people to us if they have clients that want to invest in alternatives. So there are people out there, but a lot of investment professionals will tell their clients that they can't do that.
Well, or they'll say, well, if you want to invest in real estate, I've got these REITs that you can invest in, which is a completely different investment animal than, say, a secured deed of trust or real estate itself.
Well, here's the thing: for the audience listening, the audience should have choice as to having someone who's completely independent. So if you have like a mutual fund company, you can do your IRA directly with a mutual fund company, and they'll charge you practically nothing. But you're limited to buying their mutual funds only.
Right.
Then you go to like a little bit of a brokerage, Charles Schwab, for example. Okay. Now you can invest with Schwab, but again, they're going to be limited to as to what you can invest in. You can't invest in deeds of trust and that sort of thing. So you're better off investing. So you're better off having a custodian like IRA Services Trust Company, which is personally where I have my IRA because I want to invest in whatever I want to invest in. And their fees are low. So he's just shaking his head because he didn't agree with me.
It's radio, Michael.
Yeah, no one can see you on that.
So if people switch their IRA to you, they still could invest in stocks and mutual funds and bonds. They're not limited to alternatives.
That's correct. We have a brokerage relationship, so people can buy stocks and mutual funds, which we do all the time. However, if that's all they want to do, then they're really better off with a discount broker.
And that goes to my next question here is what assets are allowed and which ones are prohibited? Because, like, I was kidding around about the lottery tickets. I don't think you're allowed to buy lottery tickets, are you?
Really, there's almost nothing you can't invest in through a self-directed account. The only things that you can't do are collectibles, and you can't invest in an S-Corp. Life insurance.
I thought I saw on the list of prescribed investments.
Prescribed or prohibited?
Prohibited.
Yeah. Prescribed would be positive.
Prohibited is a nudist colony.
Yeah.
Actually,
if it's real estate, I don't know why not.
Yeah. We have a lot of people who invested in hardwood trees in Costa Rica. It was a company, and they were offering lots of 100 trees, and they planted them as seedlings. And when they grew for 20 years and harvested them,
is that a real investment? That's not like tulip bulbs.
Yeah, really, from 1600 to the Dutch.
Well, actually, the company's not doing well, I understand.
You guys are completely independent. I mean, theory, you guys don't care what these people invest in because you're just holding the assets.
That's correct.
Okay.
That's absolutely
right. All right, guys, we're going to cut to our first commercial break. We got a few more great questions for you because, audience, you're going to want to hear what Michael has to say about IRA self-directed accounts because his company is about the cheapest one out there, and people know me know I'm frugal. And I pick only companies that don't charge much. All right, here is our, actually, before we go to our commercial break, remember, guys, last week we had a special trivia contest where the winner was going to receive a two-night stay at the Wine Country Inn, and surrounded by vineyards and secluded up a country lane, the Wine Country Inn has evolved from the Napa Valley's very first, bed and breakfast inn into a magnificent antique-filled boutique hotel. Their award-winning Country Inn, along with its close proximity to many of Napa Valley's finest wineries and restaurants, makes the Wine Country Inn a perfect Wine Country vacation or weekend getaway. Call 888-465-4608 or go to winecountryinn.com. And here was a question, if you remember. What do more than half of people do? They do this at, What do more than half of people do this at the table while eating?
Burp.
No, they always use paper plates. Can you believe that? And Roberta from San Francisco got that. And remind me never to go over to her house to eat. I don't want to eat off paper plates. Okay,
It's much easier to clean when you got kids.
Well, that's true. That's a good point. Okay, here's our first trivia question. Again, the theme is teammate nicknames. All right. Mark Duper and Mark Clayton played for the Miami Dolphins. Remember that during the 1980s. What was the nickname given to this duo? The first three callers with the correct answer win a free three-day, two-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Their website is lighthouseforfun.com. I see Michael raising his hand. You can answer after we come back from commercial break. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912-1190 to answer this question. Mark Duper and Mark Clayton played for the Miami Dolphins. What was the nickname given to this duo? 888 912-1190. Make sure to include your name and your email address, and remember to speak slowly and spell out your email for us one letter at a time, and we'll be right back. Excellent. You know the answer. Someone's breathing into this thing.
All right.
Everyone, hold your breath.
I might be doing it, but I don't know that I'm doing it.
Well, sometimes you just breathe through your nose and you don't know it. It just, the microphone will catch
it. It was so funny. We had Larry
Lee.
Yeah, it was so funny. He was like, I mean, fortunately, we were live and the guy was able to turn it down.
Yeah, we were at the studio. So
That was fast. We'll get into
so you'll reintroduce him again.
Yes.
Michael McNair from IRA Services. We're talking about self-directed IRAs.
Cemetery plots. I didn't realize we'd done any of those. Mm-hmm.
Cemetery plots?
Yeah. Wow.
Is that an investment? Do they appreciate value? It's real estate.
But it would be prohibited if you died and buried yourself in that plot. That would be, then they'd have to.
Okay, let's get it. That's good.
That's good.
I like that. That's good.
That would be a prohibited transaction.
So the idea in a nutshell, because this is important actually for self-directed investments, is you can't personally benefit individually from the investment.
Right.
Like, except for making money on it.
Right. So if you invest in real estate, you're not supposed to do the work yourself to improve it.
That's a classic.
You're not supposed to move in, or your son or your mother, but your brother can.
Yes.
I mean, it's just not that we want to go into abstract detail necessarily, but
nope, that's good stuff.
Yeah, there are some, the point being there are restrictions that are important to know about self-directed IRAs, but there are so many advantages that far outweigh the restrictions.
Okay, yeah, why don't we get into that, and then you can go into your question of the cost.
So is that a question? How would I?
The differences in the, what to look for in a custodian.
Yeah, how do we determine?
You guys,
who's going to
ask that?
I can.
Okay.
That, okay. You want to leave that one off?
Sure.
Lead off with that? Okay.
Oh, I'll just leave it off.
Lead off with that.
Very important. Don't leave. Okay, guys, ready? Mr. Kaima?
Ready.
Ready, Teddy? Yeah, do your breathing now because you got to stop breathing when I get the. Ready?
That's the new guy.
All right, got it.
Always blame the new guy.
Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with my co-host Mark Hoff of Pacific Private Money and Robert Schiff of RPM Mortgage. We're in the studio here with Michael McNair with IRA Trust Services Company. That's a big one. And I want to remind the audience, or let the audience know, that before the end of the show, we're going to give away one of his books that he didn't write it, but you did read it.
At least he brought it with him.
My total contribution was that I made a testimonial for the author.
Okay, there you go. It's called Leverage Your IRA, Maximize Your Profits with Real Estate. And we're going to give out 3 free books. So, audience, get ready for that one.
That's great information.
It looks terrific. I'm definitely going to read that.
Okay. Oh, it's pretty.
Here was our first trivia question. Mark Duper and Mark Clayton played for the Miami Dolphins. What was the nickname given to this duo? I see two heads shaking. No. What did I say last time?
Trust Services.
You know what? I got to get it right. It's IRA Trust, IRA Services Trust Company. I'm sorry.
IRA Services.
There you go. Okay. So what was the nickname given to those two?
I'm guessing it's the Marx Brothers.
It was the Marx Brothers.
Yes.
Very good.
Okay, what do I win?
You have a free day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Okay, so Michael McNair from IRA Services Trust Company is in the studio here. And Robert, you are going to go right into a great question.
Yeah, we were talking about people deciding to get self-directed IRAs, and if they decide to, how they determine whom they should go to.
That's a good question. And the way I look at it, if I was going to open an account, these are the things that I would take into consideration. First and probably foremost is, what is it going to cost me to hold an account there? And that includes startup fees, transaction fees, and then ongoing maintenance fees. And not to leave out termination fees, because some custodians will charge you reasonable fees, but if you try to leave them, they will really hit you hard. So those are the main things regarding the fees. And then the other thing I think is important, although we have investors all across the country, over 35,000 now, is that it's sometimes helpful if you're doing a lot of transactions if they're in the same time zone. Our customer service hours are 8 to 5 Pacific time. If people are on the East Coast, it's somewhat of a disadvantage for them. But of course,
just tell them to move.
Yeah, that's right. And we have a lot of flexibility through our website. People can open their account that way. They can get information there. But still, for some people, they like somebody close to home.
And how do the fees for self-directed hire compare to fees for not self-directed hire?
Or even, can I ask you the question?
Non-direct.
No, not so much that. But what differentiates your self-directed IRA company from other ones that are self-directed, but there's a huge difference?
Yeah. Well, to the first point, people that come from a brokerage account and move their cash over to a company like ours to make investments in alternatives, they're looking for very small fees. They're expecting very small fees because a brokerage firm only charges them when they execute a transaction, typically.
Sure.
They're making money, however, on the trades, and they're getting a lot of trades. We, on the other hand, we charge a fixed fee to open the account and a fee to maintain the account, and then, again, a termination fee. But they tend to be, $40 to open an account, $75 to maintain the account on an annual basis.
Is that regardless of the amount, or is it $40 per 100?
No, not quite. Yeah.
See, to me, that was the biggest thing, because some companies are charging a percentage of assets. I mean, they're not managing them. All they're doing is just holding them. So if I have, let's say a bank CD, right, and it's worth $1,000 or it's worth $1 million, the custodian is doing the same amount of work. Why should that custodian charge me a percentage of my asset? To me, that's thievery. That's what I liked about these guys here. IRA Services Trust Company.
So your firm doesn't charge a percentage, it charges a fee.
That's correct. What we do, however, because we relate our fees to our costs, the labor involved to do the transactions. So consequently, for each additional asset a person holds in their account, they're going to pay an additional annual fee.
Well, of course, that's fair. That's fair.
So we have a fixed fee for the account, that's the $75, and then a typical, say, a trustee, for instance, is $10 a quarter. And if somebody has two of them, then it's going to be $20 a quarter, and so on. So we don't charge a fixed fee, but we do charge a fixed fee based on the assets that you hold.
Okay, so the people who shouldn't go to you would be somebody who has $1,000 and it's a dollar spread out into 1,000 different assets, then it doesn't make sense.
And we have that situation we have some clients who have 40 trust deeds in their account. And even though that seems like a lot and a lot of money on an annual basis, and it is, it's still less than most of our competitors because
they're not
a dollar per note.
Exactly,
they're $50,000 to $100,000 sure. loan, and we're still less expensive than our competitors.
Well, and again, audience, I've done a lot of comparisons out there because I have money in my IRA and I like to do what I want to do, obviously not prohibited transactions. And in doing a lot of research, IRA Services Trust Company was the lowest out there. They've given me really good service.
Well, certainly more of my clients are IRA Services clients than any other so-called custodian. And they refer to you in the industry as IRA custodians as opposed to like an investment advisor or something like that. And
right.
Why is that term used?
So I was custodian?
About that. Yeah.
Well, because technically any IRA has to be held by a custodian. So brokerage firms and banks and mutual fund companies can act as the custodian, the keeper, if you will, of the assets held in that account.
Okay, you just don't give advice as to where they should invest it.
That's right. We're not licensed to give any sort of investment advice. So people come to us only after they found an investment they like. They'll meet with Mark. Mark will talk to them about trust deeds, and then they have to find a custodian. So when they come to us, they've pretty well decided what they're going to do.
Yeah. And one more important aspect of having a self-directed IRA and choosing a custodian is when I'm working with a client who wants to invest in trust deeds, they want to use their IRA monies, and they give me the name of their IRA, oftentimes I go, not that one.
And the reason is because
oftentimes when you're buying real estate or investing in a trust deed secured note, timing is of the essence. And so there are companies out there that will take, whose business model is 3 to 5 business days after you've filled out all the forms before they can execute the wire to invest in the investment that you're targeting, whether you're buying real estate or you're investing in a trust deed. And that's so it might take 3 to 5 days to actually wire the money to the escrow company. And that really doesn't work oftentimes, particularly in the market we're in right now,
where
the only way you can buy real estate is to have a quick close, or if you want to invest in a loan that's got to close by Friday, you need to be able to have an IRA company that can respond quickly.
Yeah.
And I know from experience that your company, Michael IRA Services, does respond very quickly to requests for investments, whereas other companies, one rather large company that happened to move from San Francisco to Colorado recently, who shall remain unnamed, has turned into be one that has made the investments quite difficult.
You want someone fairly local too.
Yeah,
where
absolutely.
You call the number, somebody answers right away, and if you actually, for whatever reason, needed something immediate, you could drive to their office if you absolutely had to do that. You're not going to drive to Colorado to get something signed.
It's surprising how many people will actually drive to the office to pick up a check because they got a transaction going. We have an investor that is always at the auction picking up real estate. And so he'll come by, pick up his check, walk it over there. It happens quite a bit.
Well, Michael, you gave us some really good information. How do people get a hold of IRA Services Trust Company?
Well.
Before you do that, okay. Right now, we're going to give away 3 of these books called Leverage Your IRA. And for the first 3 callers who call our 888-912-1190 number and ask for Leverage Your IRA book, I'll send an email. You have to give us your email address so I can forward that on to IRA Services Trust Company, and then they can send you the book. All right, now, how do people get a hold of you?
Well, they can get a hold of us a couple of ways. One is through our website, which is simply www.iraservices.com. They can call us on our toll-free line, which is 1-800-248-8447, and ask for any kind of assistance they may need regarding opening an account or funding their account and so on. We help people with all aspects of opening, funding, and investing those funds. So we have people on our call center, they're available to answer all your questions.
So call now.
Call now. Call now.
No, after the show.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, Michael, thank you very much for joining us in the studio. Next week, we're going to have another special trivia contest, and the winner's going to get 2 nights at the beautiful Napa Valley Lodge. Located in the heart of the Napa Valley in the charming town of Yountville, the Napa Valley Lodge is just steps away from world-renowned restaurants, specialty shops, and award-winning wine tasting rooms. The Lodge welcomes you with a friendly and experienced staff that are committed to making your stay as special as possible. Their guest rooms feature private verandas, many with courtyard, garden, or vineyard views, vaulted ceilings, and fireplaces. Hotel's amenities include complimentary champagne, continental breakfast buffet, want to go there today, swimming pool, whirlpool, bocce ball court, poolside fire pit, spa treatment rooms, and fitness room. Holy smokes, they got a lot of stuff there. NapaValleyLodge.com. Okay, here's our second commercial break. Again, the theme is nicknames, right? And it is, what was the nickname given to the Jose Canseco and Mark McGuire duo? The first 3 callers with the correct answer win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. Their website is lighthouse4fun.com. Check them out. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912-1190 to answer this question. What was the nickname given to the Jose Canseco and Mark McGuire duo? And it wasn't the Steroid Brothers. Call 888-912-1190. Make sure to include your name and your email address, and please spell your email for us very slowly, 1 letter at a time. And don't touch that dial, because we're going to be right back. Good.
Awesome.
You know that one.
Bash Brothers.
Ash. Oh, that's what it was. I knew
what?
It was a,
yeah.
Bruce Brothers?
What?
Ash? Ash Brothers, yeah.
Yeah.
The Roid Rangers.
That's a good one. I like that. Okay.
Has any of the legislation in banking and mortgages affected your business at all?
Not really.
No Dodd-Frank regulations impeding you guys?
Caught some of that presentation. Yeah, Patrick Kelly did some of that along with Phil Ellison. No, we're technically we're a non-depository trust company, which means we can act as a custodian, but we can't hold the deposits. So we have a FDIC-insured bank that holds the deposits, a local community bank. So, and then we do all the reporting to the IRS that we need to do to keep the IRA compliant. So.
What percentage would you say of your loans are from IRS? And is that growing?
It is growing, but surprisingly lower than I would expect, which tells me that there's a lot, because there's a lot of people just investing free cash from their personal accounts or their family trusts and not taking advantage of tax-deferred
nature. You know, the thing in the Bay Area, or all of California for that matter, there's been so many people that have had jobs where they have 401k plans, and then they'll move. I mean, it used to be, 25 years and you retired from the company, but it hasn't been the case for a long time. So there's a lot of idle 401k money out there that I think is a great source for this kind of investing. Because there, most people, and I was one of them, didn't pay any attention to how it was performing, what funds it was in, and whether I should
put money
in.
And
it wouldn't matter because you didn't have any control at all.
But you guys don't handle HSAs, right? Because you're just strictly IRAs.
No, we actually the only thing we handle all the different types of IRAs and educational savings accounts, which are like 529 plans, but they're a little more flexible. But the contribution limits are pathetically low, and why they haven't raised that, because that would be a big benefit to people.
Health savings
account.
Yeah,
it's like a picture of an IRA, but you can use it for medical. Okay. Do you want to go into email time, or is there anything? Okay.
And then you may be able to loop back around and
ask questions.
Talk about, might as well keep it in the realm of investing. Investing.
Okay, great.
Yes.
Good name for the show.
Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with my co-host Mark Hahn from Pacific Private Money, California's fastest growing private lender. You're fastest. And
we are fast.
You are fast. And we'll explain that in just a minute.
Fastest.
Fast and furious. And Robert Schiff of RPM Mortgage. And we're going to go right into,
answer
the trivia question. Right. Yes. Okay. What was the nickname given to the Jose Canseco and Mark McGuire duo? What was the first thing you said?
It wasn't the Roid Rangers.
The Roid Rangers. No, that is not correct. Next.
Bash Brothers.
The Bash Brothers. That is correct. Actually, the next question I have is probably a little harder than all those. Okay, we're going to go right into email time here. Mark, how important do you think it is to diversify a portfolio of loan investments, such as laddering them, instead of investing a large amount in one loan?
So that is a fairly technical question, and it's directed at basically my company, Pacific Private Money, where we originate trust deed secured loans to real estate investors. And the money, the source of the funds for those loans, comes from private individuals who will use their IRA services, self-directed IRA account, for example, to invest in. Or some people do use their trusts and other forms of cash to invest in these high-yield notes, which pay anywhere starting from 8% to as high as 10% on average. And so so the question really is, one, when someone talks about laddering their investments, let's just say, for example, you have $1 million in savings, whether it's in your IRA or your trust or wherever it might be, and you want to invest in alternative assets because you want to grow your savings at a more effective rate. 5% or more. And so I do have clients that will invest in one or two notes, and then others who say they want to diversify or ladder those and invest in maybe take that $1 million and invest in 10 $100,000 notes or five $200,000 notes. Again, I'm just rounding as opposed to, you know, one or two notes. And I don't, you know, again, I'm not really an investment advisor from that perspective. I think there's a number of ways you could approach that. I think it's certainly hard to argue with the idea that you should maybe break up $1 million into four or five investments. The problem with, and I do have some investors who say, I don't want to invest more than $100,000 in any loan. And the problem with that is that loans in the Bay Area tend to be higher. So if you're willing to go in on a note with other investors, which is called fractionalizing, that would be where you took $100,000 of a $500,000 loan. Your investment was $100,000 in that note. And we do that quite often. That would be one way to diversify break up your money into smaller chunks.
Yeah, I guess one thing about the laddering, the one issue is that you don't know when these loans are going to get
paid
off.
That's just what I was going to ask. What do you see as the normal duration? I know you might lend the money for 1 or 2 years, but a lot of the people that are borrowing plan to get out as quickly as they can, either by fixing the property up and refinancing it and getting a conventional loan or selling the property. So what would you say is an average time if there's such a thing?
Well, it's actually... it is more short-term today than it might have been, say, 5 years ago. If you've been investing in trust deeds for a number of years, years ago, probably it was easier to find a 2, 3, or even 5-year note to invest in. Nowadays, the biggest demand for a private money loan is by real estate investors who are buying, fixing, and flipping and want a short-term loan. So I have a number of investors who developed kind of a short-term mentality or strategy to react to this new market. So as opposed to fighting it and saying, well, I'm just going to wait till I can get a 2 or 3 year loan, and then your money sits in a money market account earning less than a 0.25% interest.
And unless you can guarantee that it'll stay out for 2 years.
Or you can become a little bit more active and engaged and invest in short-term notes of a duration that might average, let's say, 6 months. And yeah, it's more work and it's more activity than you might want to do with your investments. But quite frankly, I think the rewards are worth it. Is a pretty amazing return.
Well, and the thing is, the rates are going to come down because Wall Street is getting smart and they're starting to come up with a lot of money to go after these deeds of trust. And so,
I agree.
The audience out there, I think you need to kind of get involved sooner rather than later because it's going to go by the wayside. Well, not by the wayside.
No, I think private lending is always going to be an industry.
True,
just whether or not you're going to,
the rates are going to get
right.
Squeezed,
8 to 10 is going to turn into 6 to 8.
Correct.
At least if some of the predictions come true.
Yeah.
And again, that's still nothing to speak.
Is that a function of how much money and how much product is out there, how many borrowers and how many people will?
Well, it's always it's supply demand. I mean, if Wall Street comes in and just starts saying, listen, we'll do rates at 8% instead of 11%.
You mean they might do it as hard money lenders?
Basically,
they might do it
in
conglomerations of large amounts of houses. Or...
correct. I mean, that's kind of what I see. It's already starting to happen.
But not on an individual basis. Not the Wall Street's not going to say we have a
$100,000 loan.
Yes. Yeah.
Generally, I don't see that happening. But still, just because it's out there, tends to squeeze the market a little bit more. Mark, how do people get a hold of you?
So go to our website, pacificprivatemoney.com, or call us at 415-883-2150, and we'd be happy to answer any questions you might have about how to learn more about investing in trustee secured notes.
Or you can always go to
thebestofinvesting.com
website. Okay.
Absolutely.
Robert, we have a question here for you. How long have you been in the mortgage business? The reason I'm emailing this is because I'm wondering how important it is to deal with a seasoned broker. Now, you look like you're about 12 years old, so...
very, very salty.
Very
salty for my seasoning. I've been in the mortgage broker industry for almost 20 years now. And prior to that, I was in real estate and real estate development and buying and selling.
Okay, so you've seen
and
a lot.
So,
you're quite seasoned.
I mean, you would hope that your proposed surgeon had done the operation more than once or twice. Not that I'm a surgeon, but there is a certain level of knowledge and sophistication that you would hope the person you go to is aware of and using, especially these days where the complications of getting a loan are so much more than they have been in the past.
That's a good point, because in the old days, you should just walk to the bank.
You would ask the people if they could fog the mirror.
Yeah.
And I don't even know if they had to answer. today it's incredibly cumbersome and difficult to.
Give us an example as to why. I mean, I'm thinking, okay, if I'm the audience listening to this and I hear, okay, this guy's been in the business a long time, what advantage is that going to give me over someone who's hasn't been in the business?
Well, one of the things I like about my job is that most of the times people come to me for a refinance or a purchase loan, there's something that's slightly different about that. There's hardly ever some vanilla loan, straight vanilla loan, especially these days. There's always some little quirk. And if you aren't aware of that and don't address it up front, you may end up having to deal with that at funding, at the closing. I just had somebody in my office who had a problem that they dealt with, and it came up right when they were ready to fund the purchase. So ideally, you want to have somebody that has enough breadth of experience to be able to look and see what possible problems they might encounter and deal with that right up front.
It doesn't cost any more to have someone who's seasoned than someone who's not so seasoned, right?
Yes.
Okay. So how do people get a hold of you if they need a mortgage?
My company is RPM Mortgage, apparently the second largest residential lender in the Bay Area.
Okay.
And my name is Robert Schiff. You can go to our website at RPM Mortgage, or you can always call me on my cell at 415-515-1941. Or check me out through the Best of Investing.
Yeah, and there's been definitely some questions here off camera that we've asked you, and you've been very knowledgeable. So I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. Okay, we're going to cut to our third commercial break. When we come back, we're going to get into some economic stuff and what's going on in the economic world of today. All right, here's the third trivia question. What was the name given to the Chicago White Sox after the 1919 scandal? You remember that was a scandal with the Cincinnati Reds where they didn't they threw some of the games.
Was that the White Sox?
That was the Chicago White Sox. But there was a nickname that was given to them after this. And in fact, it was if I'm not mistaken, it was because of this situation that they changed the rules so that the baseball players only get paid on the first four games. Because what they did was they made a deal with the Cincinnati Reds. Some of the players did because they weren't getting paid enough. So they said, hey, look. You win the first game, we'll win the second, you win the third, we'll win the fourth, and then we'll fight it out in the last couple of games. And
so that's true today, they don't get a percentage of the purse?
Only the first four games, but so that there's no collusion to make it last longer than that. Okay, so that's our question, is what was the nickname given to the Chicago White Sox after the 1919 scandal? That was the, say it ain't so, Joe, right? Shoeless Joe Jackson? The first three callers with the correct answer are going to win a free 3-day, 2-night stay at the Lighthouse Resort. We always have fun here, like that little trivia. Their website is lighthouseforfun.com. Call 888-912-1190. That's 888-912-1190 to answer this question. What was the nickname given to the Chicago White Sox after the 1919 scandal? That's when also Kennesaw came in, Mountain Landis, that's his name, the commissioner. Okay, make sure to include your name and your email address, and please speak slowly and spell out your email for us one letter at a time, and we'll be right back. Excellent.
Judge Landis.
Michael, you're even quoted in this book, Michael. It's published.
You okay there? Well,
yeah.
I have a tickle in my throat.
Really, I have a small epiglottis, so I have to tip my head. In fact, yesterday I almost choked to death. My wife and I went out for Valentine's, and I took a sip of a drink.
Happy Valentine's, honey.
Yeah, exactly. Do I have to call 911? Okay.
Did you have some economic news you were going to share? or are we just going to yuck it up with Michael for the last time?
Do you guys have anything fun?
When it comes to economic news, boy, I'm not the guy.
Are you tracking any real estate or listening to anybody talk about what's happening in the real estate market? Just because I know you do a lot of, a lot of your clients are buying real estate or investing in
trying to ask the whole thing. The whole camera's been on you the whole time.
Oh, yeah. It's a hidden camera right up there.
I'm going to go sit out there in case I have another spasm.
Another attack. All
right. Yeah, you can just have a seat right there.
All
Not so much.
Okay.
Because I don't see the paperwork that comes through, like Ignacio do, and we're just crunching it out. It may not be appropriate for the next statement, but I was thinking of talking about the idle 401k money. I would think would be a good thing for you to talk about, because it's a great resource, and I think a lot of people don't think about it. I really do, and God, it's just incredible.
Are there many restrictions for just, you know, rolling? Is it called rolling that
yes,
over?
Yes, you roll it over into a self-directed IRA. Now, there's also things called solo 401ks.
Right.
But that's still a self-directed instrument, and it's separate from, you know, an IBM 401k plan or something. You know, they'd have to move it out of that.
Yeah.
But it's still qualified. They don't pay tax on the rollover if they're no longer working for the company, if they're no longer an active participant.
And it doesn't matter what kind of IRA. Could it be a SEP IRA or a Roth IRA? Or it
yep.
matter.
Okay.
If they want to open a Roth IRA and they want to roll money over from 401k, and it's not a Roth 401k, then they're going to pay some tax
yeah.
on the amount they roll over. But they can do that gradually by putting it into a traditional account and then kind of converting some of it each year to minimize
the pain. Take a regular IRA and roll it over into a regular self-directed IRA without having to pay tax.
Right. Yeah.
Just heard a situation where a guy, he only allowed one rollover within a calendar year period, right?
Yeah, 12 months. Yeah.
12 months. And so what he did was he did a rollover, and then like 11 months and 2 weeks later forgot, and he did another rollover, and the planner figured that out quickly. And so what he did was he converted it to a Roth, and then he converted it back. He said that would solve the problem. You heard that?
I didn't think about that. It doesn't make any sense, because it's the...
Said.
It's the distribution from the account, and then the subsequent deposit. So I don't know how that would change those numbers. But the fact is, the IRS is not told. We do not report the dates that we distribute money or the dates we receive money that's being rolled over.
You shouldn't even report doing rollovers. Or
there's no way that they would know it.
Yeah, that's a good point.
But
unless they
have to audit you for some reason to actually get in and look at the transaction dates.
I like companies that you can work with that don't hassle you about everything.
We've done some very creative things when it comes to rollovers, and yeah, oh God.
I had an interesting thing happen to somebody who had a deed in lieu of, and they had to wait 2 years, and then they could go get another loan. And so we waited the 2 years and went to get another loan, and we couldn't get the loan. Because when the banks ran the credit report, it was still showing foreclosure. And researched it and found out the reason is that one of the three credit bureaus doesn't have a system to report short sales or deeds in lieu of different than foreclosures.
Oh, that's crazy.
So, and I called the people that pull our credit reports, and I said, what do you do? And she said, I have this conversation 3 to 5 times a day.
Yeah,
every day.
Wow. But you know that's kind of interesting.
So
let's
just amazing.
Okay. Well, let's do that. We got 9 minutes to go. Any other specific economic things?
I like the idea that Michael had talking about people with idle 401ks.
Okay.
They might want to consider rolling them over. At least be aware that it's an option that's happening.
Okay. Well, we'll start with that, then we'll go right to yours. How's that? Okay. All right, guys, ready? And away. Welcome back to The Best of Investing. I'm Edward Brown, your host, along with Mark Hunt of Pacific Private Money and Robert Schiff of RPM Mortgage. When we cut to the third and final trivia question, we ask this question. What was the nickname given to the Chicago White Sox after the 1919 scandal? Anyone?
I don't know. Black Sox?
Black Sox. Black Sox. Very good. And Michael McNair from IRA Services Trust Company is still with us, and you were going to bring up something kind of interesting.
Yeah, it's become very apparent to us that there are just thousands of people out there that have worked for companies and subsequently left those companies. And while they were employed, they had a 401k plan. And a lot of the funding that we do actually comes from 401ks. As long as you're no longer an employee, employee of that company or an active participant in that plan, that money is available to be rolled over into a self-directed IRA, which at which time you can then self-direct it.
So is that a simple process? Because I, you're right, there are, you know, millions of people actually with these idle, so-called idle 401ks. Some of them have multiple 401ks. They've gone from company to company to company.
Exactly.
And maybe they're just thinking, well, I'll just, you know, I'll just ignore it. It's for, you know, it's for my retirement. It'll grow by default over the course of time. But that's given, you know, the lack of stock market returns, if you look at the last 10 years of market interest rates and all that kind of stuff, I would think that more people ought to take a look at that. So is it a simple process to just roll over an old 401k?
It's actually amazingly simple. And we just tell the investor to call the plan administrator. They did probably a quarterly statement. There's a phone number on there. You call that number and you say, I'm going to roll over my 401k money, or even part of it if you wish, to an IRA. And they will give you the forms. They will write the check. They will send the check usually to the participant, made payable to the custodian. They simply send that check to us, and that's a source of funding for future more alternative investments.
So the act of rolling over, that's just a term. Basically, you're just closing out old 401k accounts, opening up a new self-directed IRA, so you can choose how to invest those funds. Again, if you want to invest in stocks and bonds, you can, but if you also want of alternative asset classes, you can. So you can take multiple, you know, old 401ks and roll them over or close them out and put the money into one new self-directed IRA.
Exactly.
In fact, let me ask you, can you tell your custodian to do an IRA, to do a trustee-to-trustee transfer, or does it have to be rolled over?
With a qualified plan other than an IRA, the only way the funds can be moved is through a distribution.
Okay, so
and this is, by the way, a taxable reporting transaction. So what happens is the plan administrator will distribute the money. You get a 1099-R indicating the amount that you've withdrawn from your 401k. At the same time, when the IRA custodian receives that money, they show it as a rollover contribution. Those two transactions are both reported to the IRS, and so they offset one another, so there are no tax consequences. But people sometimes get a little nervous when you say
you're
it's going to be reported.
Yeah.
You're getting a 1099, exactly.
But you can't do a trustee-to-trustee transfer. That's only within IRA to IRA.
That's from custodian to
custodian.
Okay. That's right.
Robert, you were telling us off-air kind of a very interesting story. I think the audience should understand.
There was
about
a very interesting story.
Change the subject here.
That I came across last week and saw that many other people were experiencing also. I had a client who, during the heyday, bought a lot in Florida and was going to develop a house and make a lot of money, and everybody was doing it. In short, ultimately, it all fell apart, and she ended up giving the property back to the bank and paid them $7,000 to do it. So she had a deed in lieu of on and her credit report. We had to wait by Fannie Freddie rules 2 years before that could be erased and she could get a conventional financing. Waited the 2 years, she got prepared, and we went to refinance. And when the automated underwriting came back, she was still ineligible. And the reason was that she was still showing it as a foreclosure. And the reason for that, I found out from the company that does the credit reports, is one of the three bureaus has not learned sufficiently how to code short sales or deeds in lieu of other than foreclosures. The other two credit reporting bureaus have become sophisticated enough over the last 5 years.
That messes people up, doesn't it?
Horribly, yes. Yes.
So what happened?
So, well, I mean, there's a lot of scuttlebutt. RPM has about 400 or 500 agents, and a lot of them have experienced this problem, and some of them have worked it out one way or another, and some of them have not been able to, but there's a lot of information going around, and it's still very problematic, and so if anybody out there is waiting because they had a short sale or deed in lieu of, they might want to check with whoever they're going to work with to see that they could proceed once that time limit is done.
That's quite important.
It's quite amazing. It's one of the three bureaus that has, for whatever reason, not chosen to code those differently, and it's incredible to me because the amount of short sales and deeds in lieu of in the past 5 years.
Oh, it's tremendous. Enormous. It's important to check your credit report.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Mark, any last words before we have to cut off?
No, other than, check any...
The answer's never no.
Yes.
Yeah, there you go.
Check your old 401k accounts, and this is really important. You know, I mean, we're all, at least all of us in this room are staring down the side of retirement here. And
speak for yourself.
Self-directed.
I got another 100 years to go.
You know, self-directed IRAs are a great way to grow your savings, and again, check out IRA Services. They've got a great website. You can learn lots of information about it. It's really easy to roll over old, non-performing 401ks from your old prior jobs. This is important stuff.
And also, it doesn't have to be non-performing IRAs. It could be non-performing CDs or
non-performing CDs. That's a good one.
Non-performing money market accounts.
You know, I wasn't kidding when I said I have another 100 years to go to retirement. You know, they're going to change the Social Security law so that I probably have to be 100 and some odd years old to start collecting.
You know, keep in mind when you're opening up an IRA, too, there's the traditional IRAs and there's also Roth IRAs, which are gaining in popularity. And that's where any gains you make within that Roth IRA account are never taxed, and so that's
totally
really
changed the rules.
Well, and hopefully they don't, but at least under the rules currently, whereas a traditional IRA, of course, you get tax benefits for investing dollars in there. A Roth IRA, you don't get tax benefits for the money you put in, but the growth, at least today, and hopefully for the future, is tax-free. So again, another reason to look into it. Very interesting information. Yeah. If you call the guys at IRA Services, they'll walk you through.
You guys are bonded and everything. You're not gonna run off with my money.
Absolutely not. I might add that another benefit of the a Roth IRA for you people over 55, say, is that should you might in the future, that your children or your beneficiaries won't have to pay the taxes. It's kinda, that's a nice thing to
free
pass
money.
On.
Free money. I like that. Okay, here are our thoughts for the day. I am is reportedly the shortest sentence in the English language. Could it be that I do is the longest sentence? Just kidding. I love my marriage. At least that's what my wife tells me. And when you have your picture taken with Mickey Mouse at Disneyland, does the guy inside the costume smile for the camera? Oops. Oh, Mark, did I spoil that for you? Oh, no. Yeah, that's the real Mickey Mouse, Mark. It is. Tune in next week to The Best of Investing. We're going to be giving away 9 more free vacations for answering trivia questions. And by then, I'm sure the shock will have worn off and for Mark, right? Because I'm telling you, it's a real...
He's not digesting
the Mickey Mouse. No, the guy inside the costume is really Mickey Mouse. Anyway, okay, thanks for listening, audience. On behalf of our team, I'm Edward Brown, wishing you the best of investing. So long. Excellent.